Yes, okay.
Hi, I'm David Moore, a PhD student at Asbury Theological Seminary. This morning I'm here with Professor Angie Wright, one of the world's leading Bible scholars and one of the most widely published Christian scholars. And he's the author of over 80 books, some of which are book awards in different organizations. So I'm very glad to be with you, Professor Wright.
Thank you. Good to have you. Thank you very much.
Let us start with these questions. Can you tell me a little bit about your journey of New Testament studies and why you interest in New Testament studies?
Yes, well, I've been a Christian all my life. I grew up in a Christian home, and I started to read the Bible for myself when I was about 12, mm-hmm. and with helps from Scripture Union notes and that sort of thing. And through my teens, I and several of my friends were very interested to grapple with some of the big issues, particularly from Paul, and some of the questions about Paul's theology and predestination and justification, and all these issues were very live issues. So when I then was training for the ministry, I studied the New Testament intensively. I had done classics before, so I had Greek and Latin, and so I was able to spend a lot of time reading and reading and reading the New Testament in Greek and trying to figure out all sorts of different things. And it was my dream that maybe I would be able then to go on and do a PhD. And I just wanted to know more and more about the New Testament. So it was really just my curiosity about Paul, but then also about the question of Jesus in his historical context. What was Jesus thinking? Why was he doing these things? What did he mean by the kingdom of God? And the Bible, I'm sitting here with the Greek New Testament. The Greek New Testament has just been, well, the most important book of my life, really. And then I've also studied, obviously, Hebrew Old Testament and the Septuagint quite a lot. And it may sound silly, I've just never seen any reason to stop. I'm just as excited about these texts now as I was when I began to study them when I was in my early 20s. So it's been a matter of moving forward by lecturing, by writing, by studying, by seminars, by debating, that always there are more questions, and each time you see a new version of the big picture, that then generates more questions as well. So why would one stop?
Wow, that's impressive, yeah. And the second question is, among Christian scholars, who inspire you most and why?
Well, that's a good question, because I have been very eclectic in my reading. I always say when people ask me this question that my very good friend Richard Hayes from Duke, his work has been enormously helpful to me, and his book Echoes of Scripture in the Letters of Paul and his other books on Paul and now on the Gospels have opened up whole new vistas of new possibilities. But there are many, many others who I found helpful when I was starting out. The Romans commentary by Charles Cranfield was really important for me, and also the Romans commentary by Ernst Käsemann, the great German scholar. And when I was doing my doctorate in the 1970s, those were the two big commentaries on Romans, and they are totally different in so many ways. And I don't agree with either of them, but they are both such wonderful readers of texts and historians that they challenge you. If you're going to disagree with them, you have to do a lot of homework to figure out why you disagree and so on. So I learnt a huge amount from them, one perhaps the best of the British scholars at the time, the other perhaps the best of the German scholars at the time. And so I cut my teeth on them. But then through the 1980s, I was doing a lot of work on historical Jesus issues, and I learnt a lot from people like Ben Meyer, who not so many people read these days, but is a really, really important scholar, and also Ed Sanders. And again, I disagreed radically with Ed Sanders about a lot of things, but he was raising the question in terms of the world of first century Judaism. And so as I plunged into the first century Jewish world and got to know that better and better, then actually the most important thing for me was learning how to understand the Jewish texts, the Jewish world, because then the New Testament belongs within that first century Jewish world. And my own teacher, George Caird, who sadly died young, he died when he was in his late 60s, the same sort of age I am now, but his book, The Language and Imagery of the Bible, was enormously important to me. So those are some of my roots. And also, a great British scholar, Charlie Mole, C.F.D. Mole, M-O-U-L-E, he was very influential on me, both personally and then in his writings. And again, I don't agree with him all down the line, but the way he approached the subject, and he was a very devout and prayerful Christian man, and that was a wonderful model for me of Christian scholarship. So those are some of the starting points.
Okay, thank you, thank you. In your book, The Last Word, you said that among systematic theologians, you like Karl Barth.
Yeah.
And you don't like so much Mortmann and Ron Williams?
Well, no. I have been eclectic. I mean, one of my favorite books in the last 30 years was Miroslav Volf's book, Exclusion and Embrace. Yes, and I've read quite a bit of Miroslav's writings, and I think very highly of him. Rowan Williams and Oliver O'Donovan are both very good personal friends. And again, I love their writings, but I don't always agree with them. Moltmann, I have read 3 or 4 of his books. I haven't read the whole lot. And on Barth, I have never read the whole of the Church Dogmatics. I've read several of the volumes, but I've never been a Barth scholar, as it were. But my sense with Barth is that he gets better the more he goes on. The early Barth is exciting, but I think he is not really as close to the text of the Bible as he was later. And later he was more and more interested in what the Bible was actually saying. So, say, volume 4 of the Church Dogma, volume 4 of the Church Dogmatics, I find perhaps the most exciting stuff. But that book you mentioned, The Last Word, there is of course now a second edition, which is called Scripture and the Authority of God. Yeah. That was the original British title, and my American publisher put it out with this title, The Last Word. But I think many Christians from my world struggle with the question of the authority of Scripture. And that's why I cast it in terms of Scripture and the authority of God. It's God's authority somehow mediated through Scripture. And there I think I am on the same page as what Barth and others are trying to do.
So what do you disagree with Karl Barth?
Barth, it's hard to say, because to have a disagreement you have to be sharing a starting point. And I think one of the things that I've learned more and more is that the German theology of the early 20th century is starting in a totally different place to where British or American theology would be starting, because they are doing business with the whole liberal Protestant tradition from the 19th century and all the way back to the Reformation, in a way that so many British scholars simply weren't. We're doing different things, often more related to the patristic period than to the reformers in the 19th century. So it's a question of starting point. And I think that's why the more Barth goes on and wrestles with the Bible in a fresh way, the more we are within shouting distance of one another, as it were. Whereas the early Barth, when I read him, a lot of the time I find it difficult to see, why are you so concerned about this? And the answer is because he's dealing with Schleiermacher or Hegel or whoever, and they have never been important for British theology. And even Kierkegaard, who is important for Barth, a lot of us in Britain find Kierkegaard quite difficult, because again, he comes out of that German tradition of the early 19th century. And so then when I read Barth, there are lots of places where I say, yes, but if only we would put this in a Second Temple context, you would see that it actually doesn't sit quite like you said. Now, that's I'm generalizing,
yeah.
But in Christology, for instance, I don't disagree with what he does, Christologically particularly, but I want to say, if we understand the first century Jewish world, and particularly the temple, and the idea of Israel's God coming back to the temple, then I think this is the right matrix for holding on to what it means for God to be present in Jesus and as Jesus. But this means rethinking a lot of the older Christological categories in ways which are both similar and different to what Barth and others do. I'm sorry, this is very generalized, but as I say, I'm not a Barth scholar. I can't sort of go through and say this and that, because life is too short. I always enjoy Barth when I read him, but I haven't really read him enough to be able to engage in great detail.
Thank you very much for sharing. As I mentioned earlier, you have published about 80 books. So which of your books do you like the best?
that's like asking which of my children do I like the best, and I do not believe in having favourites among my children. But we have here on the floor the big book on Paul and the faithfulness of God. Inevitably, that represents a huge amount of my thinking over the last 40 years about Paul. So there is a great deal of what I've been doing which is now in that book. But actually, there's another book which came out just a year or two ago called Paul and His Recent Interpreters, which goes through the main lines of Pauline interpretation this last century, particularly the more recent ones in America and Britain and some in Germany. And when I go back to that now, I think, good, I really nailed some issues there, particularly some of the current Pauline interpretative issues like the so-called apocalyptic Paul and so on. And perhaps just because it's recent, I'm very happy to have done that. I think perhaps my two best-known books in America are Surprised by Hope and Simply Christian. And both of those arose out of where I was about 10 or 15 years ago. And in both cases, I think I was able to say something quite simply. They're not fully scholarly books, but I was able to summarise a lot of what I...
Kind of like meditation?
Well, not so much. That would be more... I have done some books of sermons and meditations, but Simply Christian is what it says. Okay. This is what I think Christianity is all about, and I've tried to make it as simple as possible. And Surprised by Hope was a way of saying that actually Western Christianity has been fixated on heaven and hell and all of that. But in the Bible, what really counts is new creation, the new heavens and the new earth, and the coming together of heaven and earth in Christ, as in Ephesians 1. And so that's really a challenge to Western Christianity to rethink some of its basic categories according to the Bible itself. And so those are things which I'm really, really glad I was able to do. And particularly the theme of resurrection, which has been really important to me. My big book, The Resurrection of the Son of God.
Yes.
That was a kind of a sigh of relief when I wrote that, because I was in a lot of debates where people were misunderstanding this and that and the other about resurrection. And I felt in that book I was able to draw it together and sort out these different debates within a single coherent framework. So, I say, it's like discussing your children, we know what.
Thank you. And some Western Christians don't believe in the existence of hell. So what is the biblical teaching of hell and heaven?
Yeah. Sooner or later, everybody I talk to in America wants to know about hell. Somebody asked me that just 2 hours ago at breakfast. And part of the problem here is that in Western theology, in the Middle Ages, there was a retrieval of some ancient pagan ideas with an angry God, really a violent God, and then Jesus kind of warding off this angry, violent God. And then some of the philosophical responses to that from the 15th century onwards were an attempt to say, no, we don't believe in an angry God. God is a long way away and doesn't care about who. That's Epicureanism. But then some of the Christian responses at the time of the Reformation were to say, well, yes, God is angry with us because of our sins, but fortunately Jesus died for us, and if we believe, then etc. And I want to say that the medieval picture of this angry, violent God is simply not the biblical picture. The biblical picture is of the covenant creator God who loves the world and longs to rescue and restore the world. And my fear is that when people talk about hell, often the picture they have in mind is as though John 3:16 were to say God so hated the world that he killed his only son. And it doesn't. It's God so loved the world that he gave his only son. So when we talk about hell, it's important that we do it within the right bigger framework. When we do that, and I say this in Surprised by Hope, it seems to me that the language of hell is a language about what happens when people insist on worshipping idols, with the result that they cease to be God-reflecting human beings. And when you cease to be an image-bearing human being, you are no longer a genuine human. And there is then a sense of loss and sorrow and having missed out on something which was a vocation, which a glorious thing which you were called to be and which you have turned away from. Now, I find it difficult to talk about this because if I'm realistic, I know several people who I think are doing exactly that, are turning away from God. And these are people I love and I pray for. So to talk about hell for me can never be a casual, oh yes, God will punish the wicked in hell, as though those are just other people and they don't matter. When we're talking about people who we know and love, and who we pray that they will, in fact, come back and worship God and be transformed by him. But if they say, no, I don't want that, I don't want to be transformed by this God, I want to worship this idol or that idol, they wouldn't actually say those words, but that's the effect of their lives, then I believe they are saying, I do not want to be a fully genuine human being. And that is an embrace of, we can call it hell, the Bible has many different images for that, which is a tragedy and a sorrow and a loss.
Okay. And now, what do we mean by new heaven, new earth? So God will destroy this old earth and create a new...
What God will destroy is the corruption and decay. God will... The only image we really have is the resurrection.
Yes.
Because when Jesus rose again from the dead, this is the same body, so there is no body in the tomb, and his hands and feet still have the mark of the nails and the wound of the spear. So it is the same body, but it is a new body, because it can no longer get sick, it will not die again. Paul says the Messiah being raised from the dead will never die again.
Yes.
Now, so his body is now unable to be, to suffer again, to get sick again, to die again. And so there's a radical renewal of physicality. Now, if we imagine God doing that to the present creation, then instead of creation going through the cycles of decay in the fall and winter and then rebirth in the spring, and instead of human beings getting sick and dying, God will make a world which is like this one, only full of life and power and possibility. And that's why in Revelation it says that the leaves of the tree bearing fruit every month and so on. And this is an image of a world which is very much like this, only much more so, with all the beauty and glory and joy and power of the present creation, no longer held back by corruption and decay and sickness and death. And so when the Bible talks about God doing away with the oldness is precisely the decay and the death and the sorrow. That's why in Romans 8, the present creation is groaning in travail,
yes,
which is an image of a woman giving birth.
Yes.
And so there is a new world to be born, I find that such an exciting and energizing.
Yes.
Especially granted that, because of the Holy Spirit, we have that new life already, mysteriously, and alongside suffering and pain and grief and sorrow, we also have this, in other words, we're not just waiting for the new world, it has already begun, and we get to share in it, which is an extraordinary, awesome responsibility.
Yes, yes. And another question is, some Christians believe in the idea that God created this world and heaven out of nothing. But some believe in the idea that God created the earth and heaven out of chaos, like out of something. So,
it's very mysterious, because Genesis 1 and 2 and 3 and so on, I don't think are designed to be a scientific representation. The people who've written wisely about Genesis recently will say these are very deeply true statements, but it's not designed to answer that kind of question. It seems to me that the word chaos, and the tohu vabohu in the Hebrew, without form and void, this is a way of saying God is the one who is bigger than and greater than all of this, and God is before all things, and so on. I don't think we are allowed to know the answer ultimately to the question, whether there was just nothing, or whether whoever God was in the beginning was dealing with sort of possibilities and options. I really don't think we have access to that. One of my grandsons asked me just recently who made God and what was there before God.
Yes.
And we children want to ask that question. When we grow up, we don't ask that question, but I rather think that the question you asked from God's point of view probably sounds a bit like that question. You know, children ask pretty good questions, actually. But so we want to know about this. The key thing is about the sovereignty of God, that God is not conditioned by stuff that was there beforehand. At the same time, creation is an act of love and not pure arrogant sovereignty, as it were. And what we see, so one of the things I've been wrestling with recently, which I think is really, really important, when the Bible says that God created the world in and through and for Christ, we often just think of the cosmic Christ, the second person of the Trinity, etc. But actually, what we know about Christ is Jesus. And when we see Jesus announcing God's kingdom, Jesus doesn't go around just saying, okay, we're getting rid of this and we're going to do this instead. Jesus says it's like a seed growing secretly, or like somebody sowing all kinds of seeds of which some bear fruit. That's Jesus' description of how the kingdom of God comes. Maybe we should take that as a model of what it means to say that God created the world through Christ. It's through the Christ who we know as Jesus. And I think that's a theological line which needs much further exploration.
Okay, thank you. The other question is, in the New Testament especially, when Jesus became incarnated, so it seems to many Christians or many non-Christians think that Jesus' divinity and monotheism. So it seems like God the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit, it seems like three gods and triadism, rather than monotheism. So how can God be?
Yes, this is of course difficult because we are at the borders of language. I mean, one of the things you learn as a theologian, as I'm sure you're aware, is that our language is actually quite impoverished.
Exactly.
And we are constantly then having to say, this is a picture, this is a signpost, this is pointing towards something, but that the reality is bigger. However, the key thing is to understand how ancient Jewish God language worked, because monotheism was never in Jesus' day and Paul's day a numerical doctrine about the utter oneness of God. If you look at the Shema, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one, this is a call to allegiance. It's a call to say, over against the pagans with their many gods and goddesses, and over against the dualists who think that there's a good God and a bad God or something like that, the Jews say, no, God is one, which means that the Creator is also the one who's in charge of the world, etc., and over against the pagan divinities who will distort and destroy your humanness. So this is a monotheism is a story about the Creator who is also the Redeemer. It's not a story about the inner being of who God is. And if you look at Jewish literature like the books of Enoch and so on of the time of Jesus, they are exploring the possibility that within the oneness of God, some of the wisdom literature talks about God made the world through wisdom, and wisdom becomes with a capital W, yes, like Lady Wisdom. Yes. And so the Jews are open to exploring a plurality within the oneness of God. And what the early Christians do, in shock and awe, is to look at Jesus and say, with Jesus we see who the one God really is. But Jesus talked about God as Father, so they then take the Jewish language of Father and Son, which is also royal language, and they say,